Prime Minister Shehbaz Sharif approved ₹23 billion for Azad Jammu and Kashmir after the recent clashes and protests. The Jammu Kashmir Joint Awami Action Committee demands electricity at hydropower generation cost, subsidized wheat flour, and an end to elite privileges. Arrests of 70 activists on May 9th and 10th triggered serious clashes and a shutter-down strike. Sharif chaired a special meeting in Islamabad with AJK Prime Minister Chaudhry Anwarul Haq and other leaders to review the situation. The AJK leaders appreciated PM Shehbaz's decision. The Joint Awami Action Committee's strike in Azad Jammu and Kashmir entered its third day on Sunday, halting life in Muzaffarabad as shops and transport shut down. Protesters marched towards the capital from various areas, despite government roadblocks, leading to clashes and injuries. Internet services were disrupted and paramilitary rangers were deployed to secure key sites. The strike, driven by a 10-point charter of demands, had caused widespread disruption. Despite government promises to address demands, talks remained inconclusive, prompting the protests to continue, in light of which the government offices and educational institutions remained closed on Monday. Petrol prices in Pakistan are likely to drop again from May 16th as inflation eases under the stable federal government. This would be the second decrease in petrol prices within a month. The Oil and Gas Regulatory Authority is expected to recommend the price cut due to a significant decline in international oil prices. Sources said the government is expected to cut petrol price by Rs 14 per litre and diesel by Rs 10 on May 16 for the next fortnight revision. Last month, the government slashed the price of petrol and high-speed diesel for the next fortnight by Rs 5.45 and 8.42 respectively. Deputy Prime Minister Ishaq Dar arrived in Beijing to co-chair the 5th Pakistan-China Foreign Minister's Strategic Dialogue with his Chinese counterpart Wang Yi. Dar will meet Chinese leaders, officials and business enterprises during his four-day visit from May 13th to May 16th. The dialogue will cover the full spectrum of Pakistan-China relations, including economic cooperation, the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor and regional geopolitical issues. The visit highlights the importance of deepening the all-weather strategic cooperative partnership between the two nations. Pakistan Cricket Board Chairman Mohsin Naqvi met with Ireland Cricket Chairman Brian McNeice in Dublin. McNeice represented Naqvi with an Ireland team shirt and cap, symbolizing their collaboration. They discussed promoting women's cricket and announced Ireland's tour to Pakistan in August to September next year. Naqvi also confirmed plans to review the Pakistan women's cricket team's tour to Ireland. Both expressed enthusiasm for hosting the Champions Trophy 2025 in Pakistan, with Naqvi assuring top-notch security for all international teams. Babar Azam, Pakistan's skipper, made history by becoming the most successful T20 captain with an impressive 45 wins. This milestone was achieved after Pakistan's stunning victory over Ireland, where they chased down 193 over 7 wickets with ease. Babar's record-breaking 45th T20 win as a captain puts him ahead of Aaron Finch of Australia, who has 40 victories, and Uganda's Brian Masaba, who has 44 wins in all men's T20s. Other notable captains on the list include Ian Morgan, England's 2019 World Cup winning skipper with 42 victories, and MS Dhoni and Rohit Sharma, both tied at 41 wins each. Pakistan's hockey team returned to Pakistan at Lahore International Airport after clinching silver at the Aslan Shah Hockey Cup final played in Malaysia. Prime Minister announced Rs 1 million for each hockey player who played Aslan Shah Hockey Cup. The PM Youth Loan Program Chairman Rana Masood received the hockey team and management at the Lahore International Airport. The government arranged garlands and drum beaters to celebrate the moment. Experts see the winning of silver at the Aslan Shah Cup as a step towards the revival of hockey in the country. Prime Minister Shehbaz Sharif suspended PASCO's Managing Director and General Manager for negligence in using technology for wheat procurement. He ordered a third-party audit of PASCO's stock and emphasized crop insurance for farmers' economic security. Sharif directed the development of a mobile app to ensure a transparent wheat procurement process and tasked PASCO with procuring an additional 400,000 metric tons of wheat efficiently. He stated that farmers' losses would not be tolerated and committed to recognizing top-performing PASCO centers and offices. Finance Minister Mohammad Aurangzeb emphasized the need for privatization, stating there are no strategic state-owned enterprises at a pre-budget conference in Lahore. Aurangzeb highlighted plans to digitize the tax collection system to broaden the tax base and integrate the undocumented economy. Formal discussions with the IMF will begin soon, focusing on energy, tax-to-tax GDP ratio and SOE reforms. The IMF mission has begun talks with Pakistan's Ministry of Finance, including key officials. Progress was made, agreeing on no loans from the state bank next year, timely external payments, tax refunds, improved reserves and issuing bonds. They also agreed to lift import and international transaction bans. Discussions will continue for about 2 weeks, focusing on a new loan program and the upcoming budget. The UN Relief and Works Agency, UNRWA, reported that an Israeli evacuation order forced 300,000 people to flee Rafah in Gaza. UNRWA stated, "There is nowhere safe to go," emphasizing the dire situation. The Israeli army ordered further evacuations in Rafah, causing residents to leave under military threat. UNRWA Commissioner General Philippe Lazzarini criticized the so-called safe zones as misleading, and the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, Volker Turk, expressed deep distress over the deteriorating conditions. UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres called for an immediate ceasefire and release of all hostages. Israeli tanks advanced further into Jabalia in northern Gaza, under heavy fire from air and ground, causing residents to flee. The tanks aimed for the camp's center, with airstrikes destroying houses. Several people were reported killed and wounded in overnight airstrikes. Hamas fighters engaged Israeli forces in Jabalia and Rafah. Israel's military warned of potential rocket launches from Gaza. The Gaza Health Ministry reported over 35,000 Palestinian deaths amid a deepening humanitarian crisis. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi donned a saffron turban, cooked and served a community meal at the Patna Gurudwara Sahib Shrine in Bihar. Modi, seeking a third term, is leading the BJP against a large opposition alliance in India's ongoing general election. The BJP is expected to win a majority of seats, with campaign rhetoric intensifying over economic disparities and religious divisions. India is currently in the fourth phase of the 7-week-long general election. Ukraine's Foreign Minister Dmytro Kuleba met Serbian Prime Minister on May 13th, marking the first high-level Ukrainian visit to Serbia since Russia's invasion in 2022. Kuleba and Ukrainian First Lady Olena Zelenska's visit signals Serbia's shift away from Moscow. Serbia balancing EU membership aspirations and ties with Russia and China has condemned Russia's invasion at international forums but hasn't joined sanctions against the Kremlin. Serbia has accepted Ukrainian refugees, sent humanitarian aid and pledged support for demining and rebuilding Ukraine. Russia continues its offensive in the Kharkiv region, claiming control of 4 settlements and destroying multiple Ukrainian helicopters and MiG-29 aircraft. Russian air defense intercepted 36 drones and 8 tactical missiles. Ukrainian President Zelensky confirmed ongoing defensive battles and counterattacks, noting extreme difficulties in Vovchansk due to Russian artillery. Despite the challenges, Ukrainian forces aim to inflict maximum damage on Russian troops. Flash floods in northern Afghanistan have killed over 300 people and injured more than 1,600, authorities reported. Intense rainfall on Friday caused torrents of water and mud to sweep through Baghlan, Tahar, Badakhshan and Ghor provinces, devastating villages and farmland. Baghlan was hit hardest with thousands of homes destroyed. Relief efforts are ongoing, with local authorities and aid groups calling for international assistance to address the humanitarian crisis in a country already affected by recent earthquakes and severe flooding. Heavy rain in Indonesia's West Sumatra province caused floods and landslides, leaving at least 31 dead, 15 missing, and over 40 injured. Major roads were damaged, homes destroyed, and streets blocked by debris. The Disaster Management Agency reported 84 damaged homes and 16 affected bridges, deploying heavy equipment to clear roads. MotoGP leader George Martin of Pramac Racing won the French Grand Prix, completing a weekend double. Gresini Ducati's Marc Marquez finished second with a final lap overtake of reigning champion Francesco Bagnaia. Martin's victory moved him up to 129 points, while Bagnaia is second, 38 points behind. Marquez's consistency placed him third in the standings. Martin praised his team for the perfect bike setup, celebrating two wins at Le Mans. Technology and software giant Microsoft will invest 4 billion euros in France as part of the annual Choose France Business Summit. Its president Brad Smith announced on Monday. Smith said, much of this investment money would focus on the artificial intelligence sector and that Microsoft would set up a data center in the French city of Mulhouse. French President Emmanuel Macron visited the Microsoft office in Paris, saying the investment speaks of Microsoft's confidence in AI strategy. Smith said, Microsoft supported Macron's push for European sovereignty in technology. A Chinese self-driving startup's unmanned minibus, RoboBus, is set to operate in Turin, providing short-distance transportation. Developed by PIX Moving, the vehicle will partner with Italian company Tecnogad. PIX Moving has already obtained the necessary licenses from Turin's authorities and exported a RoboBus model to Italy for field tests. The fully electric minibus, lacking traditional bus components, can carry 6 passengers and has a range of 100 to 130 kilometers per charge. RoboBus will also operate in countries including Spain, Japan, the US, and India. The Pakistan Crescent Collective, led by filmmaker Muhammad Ali Naqvi, will present Pakistan at the Cannes Film Festival 2024. The collective, comprising professionals from Karachi, London, New York, and Los Angeles, aims to promote Pakistani films globally. Naqvi emphasized the importance of such initiatives to support Pakistani cinema. The collective's program includes a filmmaker panel and the screening of Usman Riaz's The Glass Worker, Pakistan's first 2D hand-painted film. They will also co-host the launch of the South Asian Film Market and a networking event for filmmakers to pitch projects to financiers. Taylor Swift resumed her Eras Tour in Paris on May 9th, debuting new songs from her latest album, The Tortured Poets Department. She introduced a segment called Female Rage, the musical, with 7 new tracks, including So High School and I Can Do It With a Broken Heart. Swift expressed gratitude to her fans and crew on Instagram. This tour leg features new choreography, costumes, and graphics, sparking fan speculation about a possible musical adaptation. The first leg of the tour broke records, surpassing $1 billion in revenue.